The topic of today's discussion is oral history and allied history methods. As you are aware, this is again located broadly within the framework of qualitative research. So the methods we are looking at are, to begin with, oral history. Oral history is an area of study which can be used in different disciplines. It can be used by yourself also to make a record of your own life. Oral history as a method of historical recollection is not a new concept. Ancient historians like Herodotus used oral history methods or testimonies or stories that they heard to record history. Similarly, the travelers who came to India like Hyun Sang, Fa Hien and many other travelers, while they used observation to record the lifestyle of people in India, they also made use of that data which got access. But within the framework of the 19th century scientific historiography, when I say historiography, it means more than just history. It means the theoretical and ideological positions from which a certain philosophy of recording history. 19th century history, located within a positivist framework, again looked at facts. It looked at the need for documentary evidence to record histories. By the 20th century, there was an increasing demand for interpretative and qualitative aspects of human life. And this aspect became very important after the 1980s onwards because of the growth of the various movements and struggles which questioned the validity of dominant historiography. To be very definitive, it was from the University of Columbia, say approximately around the 1940s, that the use of oral history as sources of data became important. Today, of course, oral histories are taken as extremely valuable sources of data, not just for the reconstruction of histories of movements and people, but also in various other social sciences. Legal studies, for instance, have now privileged oral testimonies. For instance, the International Court of Justice made use of testimonies of women and war victims in the Bosnia crisis, because the oral narratives become very important in this aspect. The importance of oral histories is it's a very democratic method. It doesn't have to be an extremely trained person who undertakes this research. It could be a 12-year-old. It could be part of your school projects to go back into their families and record, for instance, how knowledge systems have changed, how teaching practices have changed, how has disciplinary practice practiced in the home, in the school environment changed. They could conduct an interdisciplinary study. It is basically which focuses on memory and recall. It also places the power of research in the hands of the community. Now, this is a very important point which we need to understand in little greater detail. Oral histories are a very important source of empowerment, and it requires that the distance between the researcher and the researched is also reduced. Now, you're doing an oral history of a group of women who have entered the workforce again. They may be middle-aged women, and you want them to recall how they are dealing with their new work environment. What were the changes which came about? And at that point of time, you can use oral histories. Oral histories are very important while empowering women. One important study in this direction, one of the earliest studies in India, was the Pan on Fire. This comprised a series of oral histories, life stories of Dalit women. And when you use these stories It can become a source of empowerment to other women. It can be a source of empowerment to the woman herself, because she sees herself now as an actor in the creation of history, as a person who can take charge of her life. So research itself becomes a source of empowerment. It is like other qualitative data and methods of research that can be used to solve socioeconomic problems, but equally important, even health issues. Oral histories of, say, cancer patients can help them to record what it feels like to be discriminated, what was their hospital experience, for instance, because hospital environments can be very threatening. Apart from the issue of coping with their own mortality, these people may also have to face an unsupportive medical system. It can be a method of reformulating the hospital environment, which is most sensitive to the more marginalized people who access their facilities. So oral histories are extremely important. Now, how did it develop as a historical document is a very important suggestion. Because earlier history, I said, was a record of written records. Now, by the time we come to the 70s, as people's movements developed, there was a recognition that they did not have a representation in the history. Dominant historiography, as we know, spoke about the political history, how kings ruled, how kings conquered other people, but it did not speak about how ordinary people coped with their everyday lives. How did they earn their living? How did they manage their family? And this is the subject, the social history of a particular place becomes very important in the recovery of history. Obviously, there's a limit to how far back in time you can go. 19th century oral histories are not possible. But 20th century oral history, contemporary oral histories, post-independence oral histories are definitely very important. One very important example is a book written by Urmila Pawar and Meenakshi Moon. And the translation you will find in 2008 by Vandana Sonalkar, which says, "We also made history." Now, this is about women in the Ambedkar movement. It is based on oral narratives since the early 20th century or even before, how through the influences of Phule and Savitribai Phule movement, women have come out and raised certain questions. And this is absolutely interesting. It changes your view of history. We all know the importance of Ambedkar as someone who dominated our constitutional framework. But some of the questions and issues that he placed in the Constituent Assembly were really questions that working class women put before, Dalit women put before Ambedkar. For instance, when he spoke about women's right to equal wages, it came out of the women's movement. So that it changes your framework on history. Another equally important book I'd like you all to think about is Usha Thakkar's book on Gandhian women. We all know in history about the wonderful period of India's freedom movement. We know the milestones of the salt satyagraha and the hoisting of the national flag. Gandhi is called for Purna Swaraj, etc. We know these milestones. But we also know that women participated in large numbers in the movement. But were these women only a faceless mask, behind the scenes actors? Did they have an active role to play? How and why was it possible for women to come out? What were the factors that influenced them and forced them to come out? Cannot be got from the history textbooks or even from the archival records. And therefore, what do? You take oral histories, as Usha Thakkar, who was on the faculty of SNDT, has done. Go back to these women, discuss, understand how did they manage their childcare, how did they manage the management of the home, And what was the price? And what comes out is the price that these women paid went beyond just going into prison, because there were women who lost their babies, there were women who were separated from small babies, and yet they did. This kind of a sacrifice and the making of modern Indian history would not come without oral histories. I'm going very quickly into how do we do oral history, because I think the key concern here is how do we use this particular methodology. Oral histories cannot be done in one interview. It needs many interviews. You will definitely have to take their permission, record these interviews, transcribe the notes. Now, when people talk, they don't talk in a chronological order. Especially if you're talking to poor women, they're not going to remember the date of a particular event. Now, for instance, the textile mill strike in 1960s. You're talking to women who were mill workers who later became khanawalis, that is supplying food to other mill workers because they got thrown out of, the mills were locked. They used their ability to cook, to generate income for their family and also support other mill workers. Now, this is a very interesting area of study, obviously. How did they manage? You may need to break the ice, break the distance, come back to their level. But women are not going to remember dates that you require for your recording of history. So what are they going to remember? They will probably remember, that was the year my son was born. So now, obviously, there's some work you have to do. You will have to go back, see approximately what was the age of the child, and then work your time backwards and provide a footnote which explains when it is. It doesn't mean that you cut in and say, okay, now you tell me the year. Sometimes you may interject with a question to get the more clear view of what you want to say. Then comes the issue of organizing and arranging of the material. Now, let us be clear. You're using the data of the researcher, the person who has trusted you with your story. You owe it to her to be true to what she has said. I will give you another small example. Some years ago, we all know Shekhar Kapoor made a film on Phoolan Devi. Now, Phoolan Devi said, this is not my story. It sort of made or gave prominence to certain aspects of her life story, which he saw as important. Phoolan Devi repudiated the life story, which he depicted on screen. But he turned around and said, no, that is her story, that's it. But frankly, his depiction tells us more about him than Phoolan Devi's life. So where is the ethics involved? There is no one way of doing oral history. But the ethics of research is extremely important in organizing an oral history. As I was telling you about the story of the situation, became a public controversy when Phoolan Devi repudiated Shekhar Kapoor's film on the Bandit Queen. She said the story which is narrated is so different and not representative of her life. Shekhar Kapoor dismissed her objections and claimed it. Now, I would ask you, where is the ethics in this particular situation? For the simple reason, your life story belongs to you. This is the only real part of your life which you own. It doesn't belong to anybody else. Can someone else tell you, this is not what happened in your life, this is what happened, what I say so is true of your life? In this way, you're depriving her of even the only thing which really belongs to her, that is her own life story. A good researcher will arrange the data with the help of the researched. So this becomes, ultimately the question which arises is, whose voice is heard? Is it yours or is it hers? This is a very tricky question which is of considerable importance in doing oral history narratives. And Oral histories can be of many kinds. It could be a testimonial of a particular participation in a particular movement or a struggle, or it could be a life narrative which traces the entire trajectory of her growth from the time she was small to how she grew, and how she narrates is going to depend on how she socialized. When I did some oral histories in a particular community, the first thing that people said was, what is there to say in my life? And they began in a very accepted conventional way. I'm so and so, I was born with to such and such a parents, my father was this, my mother was this, etc. So obviously it means creating a certain empathy and skill to ask certain questions. The interjections that you make should not break her flow of consciousness. Oral histories can also be a flow of consciousness. She may digress, she may remain silent on certain factors, but you cannot sit and make a judgment, why is she silent? In a particular research study conducted by C.S. Lakshmi, she interviewed a musician who spoke of an entire career on music without once referring to her husband. Did that mean that she had an unhappy marriage? Can we make such assumption? But as C.S. Lakshmi very nicely points out, that the silences have to be listened with care. Because she kept quiet about her husband, because he was so much a part of her life and her success as a musician, she never felt the need to assert herself and say, I had a happy married life. It was so much a taken for granted aspect of her life. Now, oral histories can be, like, there are very good oral histories undertaken in Bolivia, for instance, where women miners have also participated and discussed the entire flow of their life. Now, obviously, this particular oral history is linked very carefully with trade union movement. She may not necessarily go back into her childhood or growing up years. So you definitely have to have a clear idea of your research topic and what way you want to use it. So life history method, they are broadly generically similar, and life history method is to an extent an extension of the oral history method. Life history method can have many components. It is an attempt to blend the story, the biography, the autobiography of an individual with the broader social context. Now, if you're talking about this woman's participation in miners' resistance to corporate expansion, or a tribal community resisting some kind of a social change, and you're documenting that particular history, you will definitely have to contextualize it within the socio-cultural, ethnographic, the official discourse available on that particular area. And its importance is to see how do people themselves perceive the whole struggle. Now, this is not as simple as we say it is, because life stories, just as oral histories do, changes over a period of time. Memory plays a very important role, and therefore the question of memory is a very, very important aspect of oral history, life history methods. Let me give you a simple example. There is a woman who is going through a messy divorce. At that particular point of time, she probably will have a whole lot of things to say about her marriage and why she walked out. 20 years down the line or 10 years down the line, she may perhaps recall the events that happened which forced her to leave that home in a very, very different way. Perhaps she will even have a doubt, did I really need to leave? Did I overreact? So obviously, a person's story changes over a period of time. And here, the issue of human identity itself becomes very clear. None of us have a static, homogeneous identity which has remained the same from the moment we are born till today. My ideas, when I reflect at this stage of my life, may be totally different from what I would do 20 years down the line or what I would have felt a few years earlier. So these changes and transitions, the fluidity of narratives, are something which we need to look at. So life history method is more strictly located within a historical context than oral history method. Life history method is a method by which you ground the story of that individual within the social historical circumstances which influence the person's lives. This is not to say people do not have the personal power to change the trajectories of their life. But let us also recognize that society and the larger realities of societal change affects us. Let me give you simple examples. Today, women have come 100 years earlier, the only option available to women was perhaps to be a housewife. Today, due to certain forces of social reform and change, all of us are out working. This option to change has also come because of the set of circumstances, the family, the culture we are located in, and therefore we are very lucky. There are a lot of people today, women, who will not be allowed the options we have. So obviously, even if they are talented, their lives are going to be restricted by their family and larger societies. So life history method is autobiographical to the extent that it is built on the story or the narrative of the respondent. But it is also a method by which reconstruction takes place with references to other kinds of data sets. For instance, if you're doing a study on, say, someone like Madhuri Shah, who was a very, very important vice chancellor of our university, you also have record to her public role. You may have access to the newspaper clippings which covered her lifespan. And you also have her autobiography where she has narrated her own story. So with the match between these two, you can perhaps create a fresh insight into the life of this particular woman. Some of the principles of conducting interviews are more or less the same. The location, it's important to build an empathy, a bond, and this means if she turns around and asks you a question, you have to be prepared to answer it. For instance, if you're dealing with, say, a group of women who have suffered domestic violence and they have left their homes and come out, and they turn around and say, "What about you? What would you have done?" You can't say that I'm just an objective observer. You tell me, I will not respond. As a person, it's necessary for you to respond and also give her a kind of feedback. I'm not saying you empower her and make her dependent on you, because this is also a possibility we have to be aware of as researchers. But certainly we can say at that particular point of time, perhaps this was the best choice you made. You need to say, turn around and say, "No, this was a wrong thing you did. You should not have left her your home. You should have stayed there." You don't become judgmental like that. But you don't criticize her choice either, but put it in a way that she doesn't feel she did something wrong. That is disempowerment. Location is very important because the person has to have privacy. You're interviewing a woman in her house, with her mother-in-law listening, her father-in-law listening, she's not going to tell you the story of her life. There will be interjections, intrusions, and attempts to control discourse. So it may be away from a place he or she is comfortable, but at the same time, the person has to be relaxed and not taken out of her cultural milieu. Privacy is very important. Unless you assure her of privacy and her right to be silent, you cannot conduct this interview. We conducted at the Research Center for Women's Studies, we conducted some interviews of some very prominent women. So when we went back to these women with their stories, what they had narrated, they said, I'm uncomfortable with this detail. You please delete it. We are ethically bound to delete that story. It involves participant observation because it involves a great deal of empathy and also observation and able to read the silences, the words between the lines. Now, obviously, the most important thing to do is knowing the language. These are a group of rural women who speak Marathi. Obviously, you cannot talk to them in English. You have to establish a rapport with them and talk to them in their language. It is also essential to know the dialect in which they are speaking, the particular cultural idiom with which they are speaking, and this is a very important point. I told you right in the beginning, oral histories have value even while recording testimonials and when someone else is transcribing what this particular person is saying. A group of women may have been asked a particular question, which a very intimate question may be, and they may couch it in a term, in a certain expression, which may not directly refer to what has happened. So it is necessary to understand the idiom of their language. What does that mean? It's not enough to know the language per se. It's important to know the context in which a wordplay happens. So the dialect of the respondent may be different from the one known to the researcher, and this idiom of expression should also be taken into consideration along with the different meanings that one word can have many meanings. The importance of these methods is by listening to another person's story, it is possible for us to reflect on our own lives. It is possible for us to reflect on our own bias. And that is where the importance comes. Let me give you a small example. We generally, while dealing with field data, one of the core understandings that we have is you do not discuss a person's life story in public. We maintain her privacy, particularly when she's a vulnerable woman, and we have a right to. In a particular situation where we were listening, I heard the researcher publicly speak about that particular one person's life story in public. It was a public testimonial which she was giving on behalf of this particular woman. I was absolutely shocked because it violated all norms of privacy and research ethics I came to know. But here was this researcher who was very intimately connected with this particular woman, and perhaps it validated that woman's experience and it became a source of power for that particular woman. So I had to rethink some of the biases that I went into the field. So constantly there is a reflection on my own life, there is a reflection on my practices, the kinds of prejudices that I may carry it. And we need to be aware of the ground realities of the context of speech. If you were to go to a woman's house, an upper class woman's house, and you want to talk to her domestic help, and you ask that woman and you think you're doing the domestic help's oral history, and you tell her, haan, batao, kaisa laga aapko ye kaam. She's not going to say that, nahi, sab acha hai. She's not going to say that. Obviously, the context in which she makes that statement is very important. And as I've mentioned earlier, this is one of the major problems of using oral histories as methods of historic sources. As I say, stories change. The story of my life, the story of your life is also going to change over a period of time and from the location you are. So when you use the data, extreme care has to be used. We can also be aware that memory plays false. When you try to recall some of the events in your childhood and try to see what your sister is recalling of that same incident, you will find the differences between the two. Obviously, there is a certain retrospective falsification which happens based on the location and your relationship to that particular event. It may end up in glorifying that particular event or negating its importance. So this is inevitable. When you write the story, these contradictions doesn't necessarily mean the person is telling a lie. This is, in a way, not the representation of an objective reality, but rather the subjectivity of that particular woman. The inconsistencies in her speech, in her presentation, indicate more the complexity of the question as well as the differences in the interpersonal, intrapersonal relationships that affect that social reality. I've just given you examples on how it happens within the family. So the important aspect, the most difficult aspect that we feel is how do we present this data? Many social scientists try to take excerpts from a person's speech and put it in another context. But increasingly we realize it's better to present the whole data. Because for instance, even today when I see the conflict between the ideologies of Gandhi and Ambedkar movement, etc., they came from two different worldviews, and taking somebody's speech out of context and quoting it in another situation is not being fair to that person. The other important question is, there are many corruptions which come into the data sets. Now there are very, very important points which we need to note. This is the writing aspect, the most difficult aspect. It takes a lot of skills to write these stories and a lot of editorial choices you make. Now, let us see the stages through which these oral narratives have been created. There is the actual interview where, because of the kinds of questions the researcher asks, a certain worldview is created, a certain version of truth emerges, because it is an interactive process. Through the interactive process, a certain worldview gets created, a certain version of that person's life story. Then there is the transcription aspect of it. When you take the audio material and record it very clearly, rewrite it. Then there is the translation. You know how difficult translations are. You can never get the language, the connotation with which a word is used in another language. So an editorial choice happens. Then the fourth stage is the audience to whom you're presenting your data. You're presenting it to an academic group. So obviously, your language, you will tend to edit the language in a way that it's presentable to them. So through this entire trajectory, first identifying what is important, taking the recording, transcribing the recording, a certain dilution of the story comes. And like all writing, the researcher writes herself into the life story. So the very, very problematic question is, who does it reveal? The oral history of Dunn, does it reveal the life story of the researcher, or does it really reveal the values of the researcher, or does it reveal the life story as narrated by the person? So ideally, oral histories are written in the first person, as if I'm speaking about my own life. Now, this person might be speaking in dialectical languages. Now, translation, you're bringing in your version. And you are rewriting her story, really, through the very act of writing. Let me give you an example. At one time in the US, when there was the whole anti-slavery movement going on, a lot of slave narratives came out, which was attributed to the slaves themselves. Now, one such person was Sojourner Truth. This was a slave woman who escaped and was subsequently freed and became a vocal person, campaigner against the slavery. Her autobiography is written as if it's written, "Ain't I a Woman?" It's written in her own words. It was, after all, edited by someone else. So obviously the editor's worldview got imposed on her own life writing, on her own narrative, and this is what happens. The choice you make is, do you write in the first person, which again is not being very true, because ultimately you are writing yourself into the story, you're making editorial choices of what is important and what is not, and then the other aspect is, do I write in the third person? Writing in the first person is very powerful and wonderful. It makes writing that story easier because you have taken a narrative in the first person, you're just translating and trying to present. But there are certain gaps in that knowledge. How do you fill the gaps? Obviously, if she has not mentioned when a particular event happened in her life, it was during the month of the rains, you know, monsoon season. If she's as vague as that, your duty is to give some kind of a reference point through your footnoting. At that point, I think sometimes a third person becomes easier because you can contextualize the story within that particular historical frame. But this, I said, is an editorial choice you have to make. Very briefly, what we have done is to state the importance of oral histories as a method of historical research. But the oral histories that we write are not just restricted to historical research, but has value in, say, legal studies. It can be useful to point out to the war crimes, like the comfort women in the Second World War in Japan, or the Bosnian violence which happened against the Bosnians, etc. It's an important tool of empowerment, of community research also, because oral narratives of women and men from a marginalized community can indicate how development processes impacted on them. For instance, if these women were displaced because of the dams and what kind of a life they are leading, what is their situation afterwards, can all be covered through this method. And the importance of writing, the importance of informed consent, sharing, and the final theoretical question which comes up is epistemological concern, is whose story is it? Is it what you believe which is being revealed, or is it actually her story? These are some questions which are still being debated within the framework of the oral history movements.